before we get started, I think, really, I would love to ask all of you, how many of you grew up planting or working in edible landscapes? Now I want all of you to rethink as I dedicate this talk to Julia Fifield, who came out for the planting of an heirloom orchard in 1976 at Strawberry Bank. How many times do you think we've had edible plant movements in our history? It's happened over and over again. And when does it happen? When, as a culture, we see that we're getting too disconnected from the source of our food. Right now, the edible landscape movement is something that people like Julia and organizations like Garden Club of America, another organization I'm involved with, Slow Food USA and Slow Food International, are all helping bring to the forefront. Because any time as a child, you went out and picked wild chestnuts, if they were still around anywhere you lived, or raspberries or blueberries, or maybe knew where to forage wild mushrooms, or even just eat clover out of your lawn. We all had inroads to edible landscapes. It's not a brand new movement. And plants have told stories for generations. Who knows what this one is? It's rosemary for what? For remembrance. So again, this is for Julia. And if we can darken the room, I would love to start with the native edibles, because our landscapes have been planted out through generations, but a lot of what we started with here, the fabric of our landscape, is made up of native plants, plants that tell stories, plants that influence our diet. A lot of them come down to us today in ways we associate with holidays because of their seasonal nature. Edible landscapes remind us about eating seasonally, too, because how many of you would imagine you've ever eaten anything good as a strawberry that you harvested fresh and right from the sun? Can you get that from a supermarket in a plastic box in winter? They're a whole different experience. How many of you have eaten pumpkins that you've carved for Halloween? There's this whole tradition of roasting seeds, of eating pumpkins. This whole three sister planting pattern that's been practiced in this region for almost 2,000 years by Native Americans was a matter of planting beans, corn, and squash together. That's an edible landscape. It's not just a garden, because the three grow together. The beans fix nitrogen into the soil that makes fertilizer. They grow up the corn stalks, and then the pumpkins cover over the ground, and the squash and the melons, so that we kept weeds down. That was a simple planting pattern known by native people that fed you all year round because you could store those three crops. But it's also a completely nutritionally balanced diet that gives you everything you need to eat and that can be stored so that you could eat from your backyards again all year round. But beyond the gardening efforts, how many of you grew up walking through woodlands, fields, meadows, along rivers? How many of you had experiences nibbling along the way, eating things from those landscapes? How many of you eat fiddleheads in spring from the ostrich fern? That's one of the first harbingers of spring, something that we knew broke winter's back when we were eating fiddleheads and broke up that long winter's diet. How about this one, anybody? Sassafras, right there, exactly. And how many of you have had filet gumbo? Guess what the filet is? Leaf of sassafras. But how many of you drank root beers? In New England, we still call it tonic, because that tradition of spring tonics. But it was a root or bark beer that we were eating or drinking, like spruce beer and sassafras and sarsaparilla. So that was a big part of early spring as well. How about this one? Wintergreen. Wintergreen gives you what flavor? Minty. My nephew always says to me, "Uncle John, can I eat another one of those toothpaste berries?" And maybe, is the sound okay for everybody? Or is it kind of echoey? But we're okay. So that is a plant that gave a lot of flavor to life, but it also has salicylic acid, which is what?
Aspirin.
Aspirin is what we chemically replicate from that. So a medicine for your external pain in your joints, for internal use. This one's a little bit less known, but very good. Ramps are wild leeks. I just did a piece with NPR last spring on ramps and the ways that we can harvest them sustainably, how we can reseed them into environments and harvest them without pulling them up by the roots, but also ensuring that we spread them into places where they would have traditionally grown. They what? Oh, well, how many of you have eaten ramps? Wow, that's great. Co-op has them fresh. Again, another wonderful thing that as we're seeing local markets emerging in the 21st century, you're also seeing a lot more outlets for plants like this. These two are wild ginger, another one of our native plants that adds a wonderful flavor to cooking. This one, black trumpets. It's a mushroom that's wonderful. And a couple of falls ago, we had the best harvest of mushrooms I'd ever seen. Some years it's cyclical. You get really good harvests with mushrooms. The conditions are all just right. But these are things from our native environments. Black walnuts that gave us nutrition and protein all year round because you could store them. And of course our American chestnuts that were a big part of getting protein in a place where you didn't always import beef from halfway across the world to get protein, but you had sources locally like beans and chestnuts and walnuts. Well, for those of you that have any experience along the shoreline or waterways, there are also a lot of native plants that we can partake of from those environments. This one is a little bit small and hard to see, but I'll give you a clue. It grows year-round in springs and brooks. Watercress. Because where water comes up from the ground, it's always 55 degrees. So watercress can be harvested year-round in the right conditions. And those cresses gave you edible plants that were very important to break up winter time. How about this one? Prickly pear. Yeah, my mother at one point had told me when she was alive, oh, I remember prickly pear cactus fruit. My father would bring them home and they were so special. And so I was down on Cape Cod and I found a prickly pear cactus that must have been 4 feet across, 4 feet high, growing in the dunes. And I brought her back a prickly pear, and she said, oh, I forgot. This is actually pretty terrible. I grew up in the Depression, though. And things seemed a lot nicer if they had any sweetness. But not all things we look to are for sweetness. Cranberries, the native people called sasaminiash, which means sour, very sour berry. And it's because of that sourness that we use it with what? Turkey and meat as a sauce to help you digest the fats in those meats, but also something that you can wildcraft. I grew up along ponds in my last house where you could just go harvest along the shoreline of the pond, wild cranberries everywhere. Things like rose hips, we were picking for vitamin C long before we thought you had to import Minute Maid to get your vitamin C in winter time. Things like beech plum. How many of you have had beech plum jam or just eaten them fresh? It's a marvelous thing, hard to replicate because honestly, the larger the plum, the less flavor, but something that grows in shoreline conditions usually develops an incredible sweetness and flavor to it. But also one of the emerging crops that I think goes a long way in our new markets for the future are things like, anybody? Sea vegetables. Yeah, seaweed and glasswort. This is another one that tastes like, or saltwort, tastes like a salty caper almost. And seaweed that you're starting to see on your plates in restaurants and in soups and in all kinds of things because it's another edible crop we can harvest from the wild. In Portsmouth recently, I was uncovering records of one of the local brewers, Frank Jones, in the 19th and early 20th century, having thousands of pounds of seaweed harvested for his beer production. Those are things that we're now challenging our local brewers to start working with again so that we bring local back into the picture as we start growing and growing our markets. Field and pasture also provides a lot in our cultural memory. This is a lot of the sweetness in life. So, this one? Strawberry. The Native Americans called that Wutahimniash, which means heartberry. And they would say the signature on it is that it's shaped like the heart, so it reminds you it's good for thinning the blood and good for the heart in the summertime. But the leaves are also there all year round. So in wintertime, you could harvest strawberry leaves and add them to soups and stews and pottages. And that would help basically give you a little bit of green to improve your diet in winter. That was a waterfall sound effect. How'd you like that? Wild garlic grows through our lawns, and often people spend a lot of money on toxic chemicals to eradicate it. You know what you do if you were my grandmother? You'd go out and you'd pull it up and you'd cook with it, and you understood you just got free garlic that was the most powerful, pungent garlic you could get, which is also a natural antibiotic. We have things like this. Anybody?
Elderberry.
Elderberry. That's a wonderful expectorant for winter coughs and colds. What did that often get made into for winter time? Jam, wine, cordials. A cordial medicine was basically a tincture of something, but you added sugar so it made it more cordial, and it also made you more cordial when you drank it. No problem, that's a great thing if you're suffering from a winter cough or flu. But really a wonderful medicine that science still recognizes today as being highly effective. We have things like sumac that grows along the edges of our fields. That one seed cluster has 500 times the vitamin C of an orange. Again, another way that we get vitamin C in New England. Sunflower seeds. Once again, more protein, but something that every time you plant it, who's visiting that plant? Birds, squirrels, you name it. Nature is there because we're also putting something back that's helping to feed our environment. How many of you as kids suffered briars and brambles to get to those? Blackberries, raspberries. I grew up along a river in Norwell, Massachusetts, where there was a 1685 shipbuilding tavern right across from our house. And you could tell by the nature of the old plantings what was wild, what was cultivated near the house, the weeping mulberry that was hundreds of years old. But these berries were something you'd go through a thicket of wild grapes to get to behind the old mulberry. And they were things that also reminded me as a kid, what you can remind grandchildren and children and neighbors as you help teach them, which is that somebody had probably been eating from that same patch for hundreds and hundreds of years. We're all part of a generation that gets, you know, all of these things are handed down from generation to generation. We're eating a sense of place when we eat these things, whether it's from the old mulberry tree or a strawberry patch. Even things like these. Does anybody recognize these root tubers?
Sunchokes.
Sunchokes or Jerusalem artichokes? I'll be really surprised. Anybody? That's called groundnut, Apios americana, which one of the early New England governors said sustain them during starving times. They grow like a series of eggs, from goose egg size down to wren's egg size on a strand, and they'd be dug and eaten through the winter and roasted or put into soups and stews. Jerusalem artichokes or sunchokes, the earliest writers that came to find them in the New World called them Badadas of Canada, B-A-D-A-D-A-S, just like a good New Englander today. And those are basically our local potato equivalent that you could dig all winter long, but more importantly, in March and April, if April was the cruelest month. So you knew, again, how to feed yourself year-round from your own backyards. Those are the flowers of sunchokes. Even things like chicory, or succory, as they would have called it. A lot of these plants have edible greens all year round as well. Things that you can harvest sometimes even just as the snow melts away because they linger right through the winter time. But also, when we encourage these plants, when we plant these plants, we're planting for habitat. It's like the sunflowers that are native here, or the raspberries. They all put something back that nature relies on. I had a wreath left from Christmas just outside my front door, and then I have an urn where I had winterberries stuck in among what was left of the Dracaena in the urn. And I just had a flock of bluebirds, the first I'd ever seen, come to eat all the berries off of that. When you plant these things, when you encourage things like sumac that I just showed you previously, when nothing is left out there in springtime, birds that have passed over sumac in the autumn and in the winter will come out and eat that in spring. So it's an important native plant to leave. But there are also things like, again, that winterberry and the bluebirds that I mentioned, lots of the viburnum that feeds the animals in nature. I showed you American chestnuts earlier. Well, the Wild Turkey Society started to reintroduce disease-resistant American chestnuts. Why? Because the wild turkey population had been so dependent on them that they went into serious decline when the chestnuts went away. So now we're putting those back into the environment. Even things like bees. We hear a lot about decline in hives, but historically we didn't have honeybees here. Those were introduced by the 17th and 18th century. But every time we plant native plants, we encourage native pollinators that got us by beautifully when we grew the three sisters as our primary staple crops. Even things like fox grapes didn't get their name for no reason. All of these things fed nature around us. This one, who knows what it encourages? Yeah, it's milkweed. That's in the seed stage, caterpillar stage, the flower stage, but bringing around things like monarchs and even hummingbirds with native plants like bee balm that really encourage the wildlife that we love to see in our backyards, but also the wildlife that sparks the interest of kids, which is another major reason why we do all of this. So today there are new ways of thinking about planting edible gardens and landscapes. After the 1950s, we got into this idea of an American lawn and that you mowed and manicured every space around your house so that it all looked uniform and even and you didn't worry about things like gardens because after World War II, they said, well, don't be growing all this yourself. These are good times. Buy it. And we've heard that a few times in history as well. But what happens when we just go out and buy everything? We lose some of those connections to what our own backyard offers. And how many of you have seen kids being raised with no connection to the outdoors? That doesn't happen because we just buy them Lunchables. When we connect our kids up to the backyards and get them a sense of how they can plant, how they can participate in all of this, you raise a generation that was deeply affected by their yard, just like kids during World War II. So now a lot of it is finding your favorite combinations of plants. If you love nasturtium, you can teach a kid to love nasturtium. You can make wonderful salads, mixing them with cresses and greens of all types. When I was a kid, I thought my grandfather was one of the strangest people I'd ever met because he'd take a tomato and he'd plant it anywhere that he could find space in the landscape. If there was a gap between two peonies after they died away, he'd put a tomato in. If he could find a space for any fruiting vegetables or fruits, they fit into a landscape. He was born in 1889, and he knew a long span of history when not only did you need to do that, but because he did that, he also remembered, like those strawberries in the supermarket or tomatoes in the supermarket, that there is nothing better that you can buy than what truly achieved ripeness in the sun right in your own backyard. It wasn't always about consumer culture or not. It was about true flavor and nutrition. And what we're finding in scientific studies today is sometimes what you harvest that truly attained ripeness in the sun and wasn't stored and shipped will have up to 70% greater nutritional value than something that was harvested unripe and shipped, as we do on average today, thousands of miles. So it's putting in that orchard tree, remembering, like Garden Club of America and Julia, that an orchard even if it's a small orchard. I probably only put in 8 trees when I bought my house in my backyard, but I call it my orchard, and I've planted an orchard that will be there into the future, like the Garden Club of America orchard at Strawberry Bank that Julia helped plant. Do you remember how many of you were here the first time I showed that slide of the orchard at Strawberry Bank? And she piped up and said, I planted those trees when they were as big around as my thumb. That's how I met her. How many of you have planted trees that are now as big as a house? Yeah, me too. And it's gratifying because you leave a legacy. That 1685 shipbuilding tavern I told you about had a Roxbury russet apple tree in front of it that the entire neighborhood would be up in playing when I was a kid. Those are the legacies we plant as we encourage native plants, and also think about planting up our whole yard or whatever portion of it that we can maintain. There are also ways of getting really creative in the 21st century that maybe none of us grew up doing. But that's another nice part about letting kids help lead the way and learning between the generations back and forth. Whoever imagined you could take a gutter and plant it up? Now that's along the edge of a garden shed. Where it comes down low, it's like a salt box roof on the back garden shed, so you can harvest from it. Shakes, so it's something that just utilizes one more space, but it naturally collects rainwater and gives good enough drainage. This is a wood pile that's just made, there's a little bit of a lean-to made out of birch going over it, but it's planted with a green roof. And green roofs don't have to be just succulents and things like that. More and more people are planting them up with food plants that we can take through the year. A lot of us don't have garden space, but potting plants up and planting our favorite greens, or how many of you grow kale? Kale grows year-round. There are about 2 months in winter when it looks like this, and I kind of do too. But in the wintertime, you let it be, and then by March, some years, February, it starts putting out new leaves. I bet it go till about July the following year, when the new plants finally overtake the old. I let it go to seed, I save the seeds, I enjoy eating the flowers, and the seed pods will get pickled beyond what I needed. But that's almost 12 month a year production. Things like that you can grow in pots, Swiss chard, things that just put out food non-stop, so that sometimes you're just encouraged to think, oh, well, I better cook with that, or else there's what am I going to do with it? It's just there's so much abundance that a couple of pots can put out. So suddenly you start getting inventive with it. How many of you have seen wooden pallets just get thrown away or burned? This is another new style that I'm seeing more and more of. People that just do pallets leaned up against a wall with a board on it. Some are hung on the side walls like green walls. And all using edible plants. Your parsley, chervil, lettuce, spinach, endive, chicory, all kinds of things that you could be growing in spaces like that. Now, who thinks that's ugly? That's outlawed in a lot of towns that would say you can't have a garden in your front yard. How many of you would think, or a vegetable garden? How many of you grew up in towns where you couldn't hang out laundry, you couldn't keep chickens, you couldn't keep a garden in your front yard? Those are laws that were put in place to make us buy more stuff, to create uniformity. But there's also a forgetting that there's so much beauty in a well-done edible landscape. This is a beautiful space that I think is one of the most charming I've ever seen. But it's a mix of potted plants like rosemary, but also things like squash growing in pots, rosemary and thyme growing in the landscape, but even corn and beans and squash and peppers and tomatoes. Try that for art, an artistic landscape. Not everybody has to do this, but it's just a reminder of the potential in it. Using vertical plantings like beans going up poles to maximize the use of space. Arbors to maximize the use of space, even in a small area. But also, it's finding the beauty in these things. In the Victorian era, when they first knew eggplant in this country, well, first of all, guess what size, shape, and color eggplant were? How did they get their name? They were little white fruit that looked like an egg. But they saw beauty in the flowers of them and in the fruit of them. And for a long while, we just grew them for their ornamental value. Tomatoes through history when we first encountered them. We were calling them apples of love, and we weren't eating them. We thought they were poisonous, but boy, did we think they were beautiful. So many of our vegetables, it's just looking at them with a new eye. Beans and their flowers, edible flowers as well, then bring you wonderful beans that you can eat. And just think of all the lessons inherent in this that you can teach to the kids around you that they so desperately need to learn from. And mostly it's just in finding the beauty in that, but also remembering that if a tomato splits or an eggplant is misshapen, that in America we'd throw that away before it ever came to market. We teach different values when we eat locally. And we say, no, that split tomato is the one you eat today. That funny shaped eggplant is one that you turn into something comical before you eat it. And those are the ways we instill values that we used to call Yankee thrift, that now we just teach kids that you don't waste and you cultivate things that you put work into and you find meaning in. Because that next generation has been growing up since World War II or post-World War II in the 50s, crawling across lawns that were basically using up weapons waste. What we've discovered in the last decade is that the nitrogen that they were using for making bombs was turned into what? Our chemical lawn industry. And 70% of the agricultural chemicals that you and I grew up with have been taken off of the market over the years because of toxicity issues. Quietly, they disappear, but we're always reminded that instead of subjecting ourselves to these things, or more importantly, the kids in our environment who are closer to the ground, why not plant out these things? Why not experiment with organic? And so, even edible lawns are another way of the future that we're starting to look to and find beauty in. Because really, like in my family, if we had dandelions in the lawn, when my mother's mother, who was also born in the 19th century, would come over in the spring, she'd be out in the lawn with a penknife, digging out every single one of those dandelions. Not because she didn't see the beauty in them, but because we would eat them in spring as a spring tonic before they got bitter. Sarah Goodwin, whose garden we keep at Strawberry Bank, said, "I will not allow my gardener to not see the beauty in the dandelions and daisy and clover in my garden, for no one lawn should be of one thing." Beauty in our garden, our lawn. So we're getting back to that place where instead of a monoculture, we're recognizing that a lawn can be lots of things. I talked about eating the clover in your lawn or the sour grass or trefoil. How many of you ate that growing up? Those little sour leaves or popped open the seeds or the flowers? The English daisy or Bellis perennis. It's another pretty alternative, wouldn't you say? You can use things like Irish moss, our ordinary moss and lichens in a landscape, and then the things like wintergreen that come through if you have a shady patch. How many of you struggle under trees where the roots are too close to the surface and keep trying to plant lawns instead of recognizing the beauty in moss? Where I used to live in Japan, they went to great pains to bring moss into a landscape because it was so lush and green and evoked such peacefulness. Things like ajuga that we put down tons of broadleaf chemicals for, and dandelions, they make up a big part of my lawn. Chamomile and yarrow growing in lawns, but then also in things like thyme bloom. Can you imagine anything more pretty than that in just a basic green lawn that we've mowed? And for all of that we were told that lawns were to represent the leisure time we found with industrialization, how many of you think you actually got more leisure time because of mowing lawns in your life? It robs us of that. So when we can plant something that doesn't even require mowing, except maybe once or twice a year, that's a great pleasure. It's another time garden here. And this new trend towards turning your lawn into garden is another side of it that I see great benefit in. A few years back, Michelle Obama, like Eleanor Roosevelt before her, said that during wartime we should think about victory gardens. Victory Gardens help win the peace. And if we can go to war over oil, well, then we should stop importing so much, and we should turn our lawns over into something that doesn't require oil to mow them, it doesn't require pesticides, but plant a garden that's really going to get your kids engaged and feed you. In my lawn, not only do I have vegetables, I have things like this. That's a picture of my front lawn of a space where mint has escaped out of an herb garden bed. Big surprise, right? But every time I do mow, because basically I've narrowed my lawn down to a very small patch the size of my little cape in front of my cape, but things like that grow throughout. So every time I mow, guess what? I get this incredible fragrance of mint wafting through the yard. But I can also just go harvest mint from my lawn. Violets, I've candied violets from the lawn, eaten the leaves of violets all year round from my lawn. This little leaf you see beside it is called ale hoof or gilgo over the ground. That's another herb that I've brewed beer with from my lawn that has edible flowers and leaves. Actually, that's my little cape and salt box. And that's the lawn, and you can see the size of it is about the size of my house. But it could be clover, it could be wild garlic coming up through a juga or a helol or prunella. It's about breaking ground, starting to think about where you might put in a little garden patch. The other part is learning to eat your weeds, because a lot of what happens is we buy plants, and we've gotten to this habit of eating the same plants over and over again. 100 years ago, there were about 2,300 plants that we considered to be part of our diet. On average today, how many plants do you think make up what most people around the world consider to be their food plants?
30?
30 is really close. Yeah, about 24 from 2,300. It was common for us to think about eating those violet leaves, or eating the wood sorrel that grows up in your lawn, or your dandelion. How many of you, what's this plant? How many of you know that? Purslane. How many of you go to great efforts to pull that out of your garden as a weed? Well, that's fine, you can pull it out of your garden, but how many of you have eaten it? So purslane was often pickled. You pickle the stalks of it, you pinch all the leaves off and put them on your salads. It's very high in calcium and oxalic acid. But anyways, it pickles very well, or you would just eat it fresh and add it into your salads. I wrote an article on that this summer, pulled up some period recipes, and they did things like make purslane tarts as well, which give you a nice lemony flavor. So it's just basically filling a tart pan and a crust with purslane and baking it. But also, when people made salads, this is a compound salad that I made last year that replicates a basically 16th, 17th century kind of compound salad where, you know, if you made a simple salad, you were just boiling spinach. But a compound salad meant you took a walk out into your backyard. You're all gardeners. If you think of all the edible plants that you would encounter in your backyard if you took kids or grandkids or neighbors out for a walk, how many different plants do you think you could find that you could eat? You'd be up there in numbers, a lot more beyond just spinach and purslane. Also, when you consider all the edible flowers, that salad, I think when we counted everything in it, we had 48 different ingredients in it that we wildcrafted from our backyard. Sometimes it's the simple stuff that we're forgetting along the way, like the chicory, which grows everywhere. You see that flower along every roadside, right? That means there's chicory leaf growing below it that's good to eat, and the root of it that we were using for coffee. This long root and big leaf, does anybody recognize that? Looks like horseradish, and that's another one that certainly takes over in a landscape, but it's burdock. How many of you have seen the seeds of that stuck to a dog's coat or, yeah. Well, in Japan, they call the root of that gobo. And anywhere that you eat burdock root, or you find burdock root, you're also finding one of the highest sources of, it's a great source of strengthening for your blood. It's just a really healthy root crop, but it's also delicious. So instead of just mowing it down or putting broadleaf pesticides on it, it comes down to digging up that root if you can, or get some kid to help you with it, and then cooking it into soups and stews, make something delicious from it. Your chamomile spread everywhere, it's time to make chamomile tea. If I had lemon balm running through my whole garden, it was time to make lemon balm tea. Or even things like this wintergreen wreath that we made to replicate a Victorian fashion. How many of you remember those from early holidays? Those are things that we can do to help encourage what grew wild around us. Putting them back into recipes from the past. These are candied borage, calendula, and angelica flowers. Well, a big part of it is also cultivating the heirloom crops and bringing them into our native landscape. So, if we're growing out pumpkins, maybe instead of every pumpkin looking like your Halloween jack-o'-lantern, you help keep something alive like this heirloom, which is called Algonquian squash or long pie pumpkin. It was dehydrated to make pumpkin pies from Nantucket to Maine, where it's been preserved for over 1,200 years in both places. Gillfeather turnip is the oldest turnip in New Hampshire. Didn't just give you an edible root, but edible leaves, seed pods, and flowers. Old varieties of tomatoes, things like Boothby Blonde Cucumber or West India Gherkins, Jimmy Nardello Peppers, they're all things that came from this region. How many of you had a grandparent or a parent that grew some crop years ago that you don't find in the supermarkets today? Do any of you keep those seeds, keep them going? A lot of the local farmers do, and a lot of what you're seeing in local farmers' markets are getting those plants back around to us. But that also helps preserve vital genetic diversity so that we have these things in the future. And the reason I bring that up is 100 years ago, when we looked in our markets, when we looked in our gardens, this is what we found for variety. You know, with lettuce, 497 varieties. Cabbage, 544 varieties, tomatoes, 408. When you go into a supermarket today,
it's from around the world.
This is something that from around the world has been narrowed down 544 to 36, 408 to 79. If you go into a supermarket among apples, you'll find about 5 parent types. Historically in New England there were over 1,000, just in New England alone. It's so important to keep this genetic diversity alive for the future, and it's a big part of why Julia Garden Club of America planted that heritage orchard at Strawberry Bank in 1976. We knew then, we need to remember now, that what we're trying to do is keep this going. Because in our past, every town, every county had a bean it was famous for, an apple it was famous for, a type of lettuce it was famous for, and that's where we had this huge diversity that we don't seem to maintain today. So it's planting for the future, planting for our children, finding the beauty in those varieties, like the early eggplant that I told you about. Or how many have eaten ground cherries? Anybody know that plant? They taste like, well, they're like, tomatillos, but they're really about the size of a very small cherry tomato, but they have a pineapple-y flavor to them. They grew here as a native plant as well, but they also reseed themselves every year. They're just a wonderful crop to keep around for, it's like candy in a garden for kids. Those apples we keep alive, old varieties of lettuce like speckled trout that a kid's gonna find fun in. Maybe trying to eat some heartsease or Johnny Jump-Ups from the garden or add them to your salad. Or when you eat a melon with a kid, saving the seeds of it so that the next year you're eating the best melon that you saved the seeds of and growing that with a kid so that they see those connections. Because really today what studies are showing is on average if you talk to kids, they will know over 1,000 corporate logos, but they'll know fewer than 10 animals and plants in their own backyard. I bet when you grew up, you knew hundreds. Kids would do things like make herbaria, press botanical specimens to learn about the plants in their backyard. They'd have school planting projects. They'd make daisy chains. They'd harvest sunflowers or walk around with a pocket full of sunflower seeds and be nibbling on those as they walked around, maybe plant some seeds. Maybe they learned from their grandparents how to save some seeds. But that was a thing that kids were engaged in. And to let them grow up knowing more name brands than they know animals and plants is almost a crime. So that's why garden clubs have, throughout the centuries, since the 19th century, been working to make sure kids and families stay engaged. I do a lot of work with Slow Food International for biodiversity, and I was just over in Italy for our national conference. And our leader of Slow Food brought up a wonderful point, and he said, a movement has no future unless it has youth. That could be the garden club movement, it could be slow food, or it could be biodiversity and agriculture. We can watch all this slip away, but we keep getting the next generations involved so that the things we value, the places we value, don't slip away. And garden clubs have always been at the forefront of that, keeping a space beautiful. Making sure things stay meaningful. So it's also planting for health, planting for vitality. I love this. Cracks me right up. But this whole idea that carrots are many things, but when you garden, when you teach a kid to garden, when you eat something that you grew yourself, that's like chicken soup. That's about love. I love this one too. Gardening is cheaper than therapy and you get tomatoes. Every gardener has known the pleasure of this, and yeah, as much as it can be a pain to weed sometimes, it's also a great pleasure to do because it's cheaper than going to the gym, and you knew that all along while you were working in the yard. Also, you know, you've all heard the adage, when life hands you lemons, make lemonade. Well, when life hands you high fructose corn syrup, citric acid, ascorbic acid, maltodextrin, sodium acid, phosphorus, all of this stuff that you're getting in your packaged foods, this is another reminder of how we can keep it simple going into the future and really make lemonade from all of this stuff. Teach these values of Yankee thrift again to a new generation, because that's health, that's wisdom, and that's also growing stronger communities. We can look at the first communities here that were a mix of Native American, all Native American, then a mix of Native American and colonial. We can see early culture in this region, people like the Victorians going out chestnutting, gathering chestnuts and walnuts to feed their families all winter. Victory garden movements, today's current eat local movement or locavore movement. And what we're reminded of is the more we have control over eating from our landscapes, the more we keep democracy alive. Because these are seeds that are not owned. How many of you know what GMOs or genetically modified organisms are? There are companies out there that want to own every single seed that is grown in the world. That is not a democratic thing. Ownership of what your grandparents grew, my grandparents grew, the Native Americans grew, that's a right to life that has been handed down through the generations. And at this point, this is all part of that whole process that reminds us that we should be in control of who grows seeds and saves seeds, not one corporation. So we teach the next generation. We get them involved. We show them why and how to care. We teach them that gratitude turns what we have into enough. We get them out maple syruping. And remember that, as Emerson and Thoreau said, if you don't want a slave trade, buy maple sugar. You'll keep New England farmers in business instead. When we buy local, we teach values to the next generation. When we get them out gathering raspberries, we teach values to the next generation. When we take them on a garden tour, get them out experiencing nature, harvesting leeks, making a salad, getting fiddleheads, we're making connections. That have been what garden clubs have been about since they started in the 19th century. It's also that ethic and aesthetic that my grandfather always talked about, which was eating the fruits of your labors. And I love this one that says, try organic food, or as your grandparents called it, food. Today you hear all these studies about whether organic food is better or worse for us. Don't let anyone deceive you. The people that would sell you what they want to sell you want to make you think that organic is not better. Thomas Jefferson ate nothing but organic food. George Washington, Martha Washington ate nothing but organic food. Your grandparents and mine ate nothing but organic food. This isn't an elitist food movement. This is about access, as we say in slow food, to good, clean, fair food for everybody. It's about what we grow that doesn't use chemicals that end up getting into our water stream. It's also about getting out in nature. Because how many of you, when you've taken a nice long walk somewhere, come back healed? How many of you work in a garden, come back feeling whole after you went out there frustrated and anxious? How many of you cook a meal with whole foods and suddenly feel like you just had chicken soup your grandmother made you? How many of you call this garden therapy? This is part of why we teach what we teach and why we bring all these things to table. Because after all, you are what you eat, as they have said through the generations. So it's really, again, needing a sense of place. It's listening to the landscape. As you take a walk out in the woods, our history is with us. That stone wall was there to separate fields from pastures over 100 years ago. Fields that maybe Native Americans kept in a day before those stone walls, or the colonists kept. When you see an old elm or an old oak, or an old chestnut. Those are things that are remnants of the past, like that apple tree. Or when you see a square plot of lawn, that's a remnant of our 1950s past. And sometimes we get the good, the bad, and the ugly, and we can leave behind what no longer suits us. And take a listen to what might just be in our own backyards hidden away. So as we say in Slow Food, if you want to preserve biodiversity, the best thing you can do is plant and eat it. That means heirloom plants, native plants, rare breed animals. But the more we ask for them in our farmers' markets, in our restaurants, in our grocers, the more we'll have those things to take into the future. And the more we teach the next generation about them, the more we can be assured there'll be a value for it. So with that, I'd love to just tell you, if you're interested, I have a Facebook page called The Heirloom Gardener, John 40, where I post regularly about eating seasonally, about slow food and biodiversity, but also if it's the season of candy violets, or if it's a time to make a tonic out of dandelions, or if you want to brew spruce beer with your son-in-law, whatever it might be, these are all things that, as I always say, help teach from the past to create a more sustainable future. So thank you very much for having me, and I'd love to open it up to questions. So thank you.